Hello everyone, my name is Stéphanie Thomé. First of all, I would like to thank the organizers for their invitation. It's really a pleasure to introduce you my project. First, I will introduce myself very briefly. I work at the Center for Research in Myology in Dr. Gourdon Group in Paris. I focus my research on the instability of trinucleotide repeats associated with more than 20 hereditary neurological and neuromuscular diseases. Today, I will try to show you how targeted single molecule real-time sequencing can improve prognosis and genetic counseling in DM1 patients. As you know, repetitive DNA sequence elements compose more than 50% of the human genome. These elements were previously considered as junk DNA. However, now they are viewed as major players in genome evolutions. Repeated DNA sequences include interspace transposable elements, such as LTR, line, and side. But we can also see the tandem repeats, including telomeric and centromeric repeats. But we can also observe megasatellites, satellites, and mini-satellites, and microsatellites. Microsatellites composed of 2-10 base pairs are highly polymorphic in the human populations. The expansion of tandem repeats can cause a range of disorders. As you can see in this slide, indeed, more than 50 inherited neurological, neuromuscular, and other diseases are associated with a short repeated expansion in tandem. This expansion can be located in the promoters or in the non-coding region, coding region, but also in the 5' untranslated region and 3' untranslated regions. The size of the pathogenic expansion is highly variable between diseases, as you can see in these slides. And the greatest expansion is observed in DM2 disease caused by CCTG expansion and DM1 disease. DM1 is a multisystemic disease characterized by a progressive deterioration of the neuromuscular functions with a prevalence of 1 for 8,000. However, this prevalence can be more frequent as in Quebec, in the region of Lac Saguenay, where 1 for 500 person is affected by this disease. The transmission is autosomal dominant, and the disease is characterized by very high variability in the nature and severity of symptoms and the age of onset. The hallmarks of DM1 is the anticipation phenomenon corresponding to an earlier onset and an increase in severity across successive generations. The DM1 phenotype is divided in 3 grades: mild, classic, and severe, and 4 or 5 main clinical categories: late onset, adult onset, juvenile infantile onset, or congenital forms. DM1 is characterized mainly by a broad clinical spectrum of symptoms, such as myotonia, muscle weakness, but also by cardiac and respiratory abnormalities. In the congenital form, the mortality is very high. The DM1 patients show also the cognitive dysfunctions, such as hypersomnolence or intellectual disability, observed in the most severe forms. The clinical variability observed in DM1 is very high and difficult for both medical care and design clinical trials. Now, what is a mutation in the DM1? DM1 is caused by the abnormal expansion of CTG repeat in 3' uterine of the dystrophia myonotica protein kinase gene. In the general population, the number of repeats is less than 37 CTG repeats and is transmitted stably to offspring and remains stable in somatic tissues. However, in the DM1 patients, the number of repeats is more than 50 CTG repeats, and tends to expand in both the germline and somatic tissues. The DM1 patients show a high intergenerational instability, bias toward expansions in 90% of transmissions. Longer expanded alleles repeat are often associated with worsening of clinical severity and an earlier age of onset, providing a molecular basis for the anticipation phenomenon observed in DM1 families. The DM1 patients show also somatic instability, and this somatic instability is defined by different size of the repeat in each cells that are represented here in this autoradiograph. This autoradiograph shows a small pool PCR, that is a PCR on the successive DNA deletions. And each band, as you can see here, represents one size of CTG repeat. The somatic mosaicism is particularly high in DM1 and progresses with age toward a larger repeat size with different rates of expansion between tissues. Recently, somatic mosaicism has been shown to contribute to the progressive nature of DM1 symptoms and to the variation in the age of onset. Among trinucleotide disorders, the DM1-associated CTG repeat is one of the longest and most unstable trinucleotide repeats. It's very important to better understand this instability, which strongly participates in the clinical variability observed in DM1 patients. Different analyses in bacteria, yeast, human, and mice gave us important information about the mechanisms of CTG repeat instability. The length and priority of the repeats alters the dynamic instability in which larger repeat and pure repeat are more unstable. The nature of the sequence surrounding the repeat are also able to modulate the instability. It has been demonstrated that the CTG repeat can form secondary structure and probably affect DNA repair, replication, and transcription, leading to the formation of expansion during these processes. In mouse model, it has shown that MSH2 and MSH3, two Myers protein of MMR, are required in the formation of expansions. Due to the complexity of both the phenotype and the gene in DM1, genotype-phenotype correlation have been difficult to establish. Dr. De Antonio from our group showed that CTG expansions lengths are widely distributed in each clinical form with overlapping between the five DM1 forms. It is therefore difficult to classify DM1 individuals into distinct clinical categories based exclusively on the size of the CTG repeat, as we can see in this graph. This result suggests the existence of other factors in the progression of the phenotype, such as somatic mosaicisms and structural variants. We know that 3-8% of the DM1 population carry repeat variants, which differ in number and type. The interrupted expanded allele are associated with stabilization of CTG repeat expansions and milder DM1 symptoms and or additional symptoms. The methylation marks observed in the DM1 and the identification of single nucleotide polymorphisms in the MSH3 genes as modifiers of instability and age of onset complicate the genotype-phenotype correlation in DM1 patients. Despite the various advances, the exact contribution of CTG repeat length, somatic mosaicisms, and or variants on the DM1 phenotype and the dynamic of instability remains poorly and partially known due to the technical difficulties in analyzing them. In the diagnostic laboratory, different methods are used to assess the CTG repeat length, such as PCR and southern blot for the large expanded allele. Currently, the most accurate method to assess the inherited CTG repeat expansion size and the level of somatic mosaicisms is small pool PCR. This method is generally carried out in research laboratories and are not easily accessible to diagnostic laboratories. Southern blot and small pool PCR do not provide information on genetic variants within and around the repeat, which can lead to misinterpretation of genetic analysis and complicate genotype-phenotype associations. Today, only the TP-PCR can give us some information about the presence or absence of interruption without indicating the type of variants. So we can know where is the interruptions, but we cannot identify the type of the sequence of this interruption. In summary, the methods used to analyze the DM1 locus will depend on the laboratories. No method gives accurate and homogeneous measurement and quantification of CTG repeat length, variant, and somatic mosaicisms. Today, the gold standard methods used in laboratories to analyze the DM1 locus clearly induce a loss of information and a bias of the interpretation of current data. It is therefore essential to accurately measure these parameters in DM1 patients using a new method to dramatically enhance our knowledge in DM1 disease and offer better diagnosis and prognosis to patients. In the lab, our objective is to introduce targeted smart long read sequencing in DM1 to better understand the variability observed in the dynamics of CTG repeat instability and disease progression between DM1 patients by measuring simultaneous CTG repeat lengths, identifying the CTG repeat variants, and quantifying somatic mosaicisms. By this method, we hope to improve the genotype-phenotype correlation in DM1. To validate targeted smart sequencing as an efficient and sensitive tool, we first reanalyzed the DM1 locus in the blood of several DM1 patients analyzed by PCR, TP-PCR, and short-read sequencing previously. In this table, I represented the information of 5 DM1 patients with a CTG repeat size range from 200 CTG to more than 1,500 CTG repeats. Patients E2.1 and E3 showed CCG interruption at the 3' end of the expansion. No information was obtained for the middle of the sequence by this conventional methods. First, we generated amplicons for each patient using barcoded primers that amplify CTG repeat sequence from expanded allele and normal allele. In order to enrich our samples with expanded allele, we purify the PCR product with AM pure XP cleanup procedure prior to smart sequencing, as you can see in this autoradiograph. Smart sequencing consists in the preparation of smart templates by adding adaptators to the barcoded amplicons to form a circular DNA molecule. A library of 10 DM1 patients can be loaded into the 1M or 8M smart cells. Circular DNA molecules with CTG repeat are sequenced multiple times to provide consensus sequences. Bioinformatic analysis were performed with LIMA from PacBio. First, we refine the CTG repeat length in L2 and L3 patients with more than 1,000 CTG repeats. So the size was estimated by PCR, but is not precise. And now I show you the one table that represents the number of CCS that we obtain and the mode of size of CTG repeat using the SQL1 and SQL2 systems. Interestingly, around 90% of CCS reads with CTG repeat expansion were represented in our library, which represent more than 5,000 CCS reads. An underrepresentation of the normal allele is observed as expected, validating the efficiency of the purification step. Using the data generated by SQL 1 and system, SQL 2 system, sorry, we estimated the size of the repeat for each patient. The mode of CTG repeat size is L2 and L3 patient is around 1,000 repeats. The approximate size of CTG repeat by conventional methods and amplicon smart sequencing match well. Sorry. In the left part of this figure, waterfall plots which outline the repeat structure of normal and expanded allele with 90% accuracy are shown. The highest peaks here represent the normal allele and the CTG repeat is represented in gray. As you can see, no interruption was identified in the large expanded allele. In the right side of the figure, the graphs represent the size distribution of CTG repeat in these patients. The y-axis shows the number of CCS read, whereas the x-axis shows the length of the CTG repeat expansion for each CCS. High somatic mosaicism is observed in these two patients, where the largest expanded allele contained 2,100 CTG repeat. So we didn't see very well, but you have to believe me. Our results reveal that SQL 1 and 2 system successfully analyze the sequence of CTG repeat in DM1 patients with more than 1,000 CTG repeat, as well as the degree of somatic mosaicism. Now, in the lab, we have also refined the DM1 locus in an atypical DM1 family, showing the CTG repeat contraction across successive generations where normal expansion should be observed. So you can see here by PCR. The repeat size estimated by PCR was shown in orange for all individuals here. So we again estimated the mode of the CTG repeat size. The mode of CTG repeat size is 447 in E1 patients with the SQL 2 system, about 383 CTG repeat for the E2.1. And we can observe the bimodal distribution for the phagocyst S3. And the size is 173 and 215. It's very interesting because in the E3 fetus, the CTG repeat length distribution is bimodal, but compared to the E1 and E2 individuals, which exhibit an unimodal distribution. The presence of two major CTG repeat lengths in the fetus suggests that the CTG repeat instability is already detectable at the early stage of embryogenesis, as previously reported in the literature with the conventional methods. In the waterfall plot, the CTG repeat is always represented in gray here, but the CCG interruptions are shown in yellow. And as you can see, we clearly detected CCG interruption by amplicon SMARC sequencing in E2.1 patients, but also in E3 individuals. The E1 individuals carry the pure expanded allele as reported by conventional methods. However, through SMARC sequencing, we can add that no interruptions are present in the middle of the sequence. So we have a new information for these patients using smart sequencing. Our results also show that the level of somatic mosaicisms decreases with the size of the repeat and the age of patients as described in the past. Our data show that amplicon smart sequencing can simultaneously measure the size of CTG repeat, identify structural variants and quantify somatic mosaicisms, indicating that these methods aggregate information given by three different and fastidious conventional methods. However, the PCR amplification biased towards shorter repeats and the difficulties inherent to the amplification of the GC-rich DM1 locus remain a deep concern. It's therefore crucial to optimize this method in DM1 to go towards accurate and homogeneous measurement in DM1. As you know, recently, amplification-free targeted sequencing has been described in several diseases and in Fuchs endothelial corneal dystrophy associated with TCF4 CTG triplet repeat expansions. The procedure consists of sequencing targeted genomic regions without amplification by using CRISPR-Cas9 enrichment technology. The first step is to prepare SmartBell template for sequencing. Briefly, for the DM1, the treated genomic DNA is digested by two functional RNA guides targeting sequence near the CTG repeat region. After RNA-directed cleavage, SmartBell adaptators are ligated to blunt template ends, leading to a SmartBell template, and then this template will be sequenced and analyzed by LIMA. In the lab, we have started to transposable this method in DM1 to minimize PCR amplification bias and improve the quality of our data. So now I will show you the preliminary result that we obtained 2 weeks ago. So first, to validate this technique, we compare PCR, amplicon, and non-amplification targeted sequencing in a DM1 patient with a large allele. Our preliminary data show that the CTG repeat expanded allele can be measured using no amplification smart sequencing. The CTG repeat size range is similar between methods, with certainly accuracy with the smart sequencing, as you can see in this different table. Interestingly, somatic mosaicisms can also be estimated by the no amplification sequencing. However, the number of CCS reads obtained with the first experiment of no amp sequencing is low and needs to be improved. The graph at the bottom of the distribution of somatic mosaicisms histograms represents the density of the CCS read for each smart sequencing experiment. In both experiments, a major peak here and here is seen at approximately 1,000 CTG repeat, representing the size of the narrated CTG repeat expansion. A second peak here is observed around 500 CTG repeat in the amplification sequencing experiment only. We didn't observe this peak for the no amp experiment. Then our preliminary result suggests that PCR amplification introduces a bias that promotes the overrepresentation of short expanding allele. So it's very important to estimate the somatic mosaicisms with the no amp. To conclude, targeted smart sequencing allows simultaneous determination of large CTG repeat expansion size, variance, and somatic mosaicisms with 90% accuracy. Our data have shown that no amp targeted smart sequencing is a promising alternative method that will overcome technical, research, and diagnosis shortcomings with translational implications to the clinic and genetic counseling. The next step of this project is to use no-amp smart sequencing and sequel-2 system to better characterize the mutation and understand the genetic and clinical variability observed in DM1 patients to help to unravel complex clinical heterogeneity. I would like to thank all participants, and please take care of yourself and your family. Bye.